off of Dad's hands.
Skills and luck, of course. Anyway, he always maintained his interest in military affairs right up to the end. Another major thing, concern of his, with nature and the environment. From working with the Wilderness University that he started, I believe in the 60s, other people can fill in better on that than I can. He was active in getting wilderness legislation passed, preserve wild areas, particularly in Colorado, and probably in other areas too. I know that he lobbied legislators, he worked with all sorts of organizations to get wilderness preserved and protected, and accomplished a great deal on that. And that was a lasting interest to build that. And the one that I'm more directly familiar with is community. Particularly the mountain community around Evergreen, but I'm sure that wherever he lived and had any time, he took an interest in what community he was in. And we worked for almost 2 years on the Evergreen Community Plan. Still had a lot of valuable input into what went into that. And lobbying to get it adopted and discussed when the Jefferson County Planning Commission got it, as for the rest of us who worked on it. But that, beside the point, we did our share. And Bill was a major contributor on that. And we developed a lasting friendship after that. We worked together on some groundwater issues, for mountain groundwater things, walking the legislature to try to get some regulations put through, walking the county to try to get some things put through with minimal success, because it's not particularly pro-development. But at least we tried. We worked hard at it. We've got a lot of good input there, too. And then the other thing where I'm also connected with Bill was the Curmudgeons, which is a local group. It is not an organization in any way. The only organized factor is the starting and ending times of meetings. Beyond that, there is no organization. It's basically chaos. So Bill went 24 years in the Army, which is highly organized, highly disciplined, to something that was totally unorganized and undisciplined. And he enjoyed every minute of it, nearly every minute of it. There would be rare occasions, perhaps, when something came up that would be otherwise. He had a number of accomplishments there. Sometimes we just sit around in both sessions. Sometimes we have political candidates come in and grill them. Sometimes we take it upon ourselves to try to get active and accomplish something for the community, and Bill was a forerunner in doing some of that. Some of the others can correct me if I'm wrong, because this happened a little before I got into the group, but I believe that the green bus that RTE runs in the Evergreen area to come and pick up seniors and students and so on who need transportation that's affordable other than a taxi or something like that. I think Bill was the instigator of that and got that right. And it's been a great success and to continue to work. Another thing, just as an example of something that he proposed, was there had been a lot of debate about, discussion rather than debate about Evergreen lacking facilities for people to do things on a general basis other than going to the rec center or something like that. And there was talk of a community center. There was an arts group that still would like to have a facility that would be permanent for Evergreen artists, for example. Well, Bill suggested that the Albertson Center be converted to that purpose and turned into a community center. Alas, it does not happen, partly because somebody would have a ton of money to come out and buy it and convert it, and that sort of funding is not readily available. But it was a very good idea, and it still is. One thing that Bill always emphasized should be in that, since it would be a community center with multi-purposes, was a firing range. I have to agree with that too. Entertainment, skill, self-defense, whatever purpose you would want. That was something that he would always bring up. And not entirely tongue-in-cheek. One thing I always remember about Bill is, regardless of what side of an issue he was on, he maintained a good sense of humor. Probably poked a hole in his cheek numerous times by sticking his tongue in there, and all he had a twinkle in his eye about things. And so, I'm not going to say much more, except that I do like to think that Mother Nature paid a little tribute to Bill at the military ceremony over at the cemetery last week. After several volleys of rifle volleys were fired in salute, six deer wandered up. They were starting to pass through, and they diverted their path and literally walked right over just above the group of us who were still there, looked at us, looked over Bill's coffin with the flag on it, wondering what was going on. And they lingered. They didn't just pass through, they actually approached and looked and waited and looked around. and then went on our way. And I'd like to thank Mother Nature, thanking Bill for his interest and his concerns. And that's all I have.
I'm filling a couple blanks he left. Tina's our next speaker. When Dad was in the hospital, the curmudgeons paid him a visit, and I went over to him and I said, "Dad, you missed the meeting yesterday. The curmudgeons have come to get you." And his eyes popped open, I think for the last time, just like, "Oh, I missed the meeting." And Jim said that he went through the door without an injury. He actually got stung by a scorpion. And the other injury he got, he was not identified for 60 years, which was a crack in one of the vertebrae in his neck. And that was actually what ultimately killed him. So even though he lived so long after World War II, since World War II, they killed him. So that's what hunched him over, was this, you know, calcification of the vertebrae in his neck. So, but he did survive through his own wild school. He said, "It helped to be a country boy and know the other doors if you're going to war." Tina. Tina's been working on his flowers for a friend, and she's very proud of the fact that she talked Dad into supporting the community garden. And like everybody else, she's a friend.
I'm sorry, I've never spoken with a magnifying glass. That's right. It's a microphone. Generally, I don't need a microphone. Everybody can hear me pretty well. Any problems in the back of the room?
Oh, no.
All right. Thank you, Pam, for a half a glass of wine to calm my nerves. Very nervous about speaking today about such a great man. When Louise asked me to speak, I was honored, but then suddenly awestruck and speechless. Sheer terror set in when I thought of just how many people would come today to honor Bill Mounsey. Surely knowing him better than I, working more closely, dealt with more day to day, and surely more of you butted heads over issues of the day than I. But I've always got something to say about horticultural ecology. Those who visit my gardens know that I never run out of words. About dirt, about nature providing if only we listen, and how ecology plays a role in all our lives, whether we are paying attention or not. And the vast opinions about man versus nature, I'll take nature's side every time, and I probably won't run short of words. But now I have to speak of a great ecologist, and the words don't come. I finally have an audience of importance. And well, after many starts and stops, delete, 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 long blank pages stare back, I find that the reality is that there are no words. None large enough that I can pronounce, that scratch a surface in attempts to explain or personify Bill Mounsey. Almost everyone here knows him better than I, longer for certain, but Louise asked me to speak, and I'm honored. What more can I say than I'm honored to know Bill and his lovely bride? I always just turned my heart to mush when Bill called Louise that, his lovely bride. Of course, as I got to know them better, I realized there was probably a lot of things he called Louise, but I just wasn't going to be privy to those. My first encounter with Bill was with the Column Ride, the RTD bus system. I'm listening to my AM partner on the B zone telling me on the radio that this guy keeps calling for a ride, but he's not in the zone. She called to tell me she's going to be running late with the transfer because she's going to go out there and find him and find where this curmudgeon lived, and sneak him a ride anyway. Neither A nor I were very good at girls. And I said, "Do you believe that? This is one of those curmudgeon guys who got the buses up here to begin with, and now he needs a ride, and he's out of the zone." I responded, "Uh-oh, I heard those curmudgeons could be pretty ornery. Is he giving you a hard time?" She said, "Actually, no, he seems pretty nice, but he is persistent." The short of it, I don't think he had to sneak too many rides before reasoning for expanding the zones become apparent to those making the decisions. But I was in contact most often with Louise, first with the garden club while she smoothly schmoozed me into being president. and secondly, through a cause near and dear to her heart, the bronze sculpture known as Flowers for a Friend. A bronze that will commemorate both she and Bill and all they've done for this community. But maybe that's a love story for another time. When working with Louise, it didn't take long to note that where Louise was concerned, so was Bill. It's what I fondly recall as a two-for-one deal. Louise actually bribed me about being president of the Garden Club by going out to dinner at the Black Hat with she and Bill. And that's where I came to know Bill. Great stories were told. I was impressed. No, delighted. No, truly inspired by all this man had accomplished. And another short story that's off script is a story of the community garden that's going to be over at Buchanan. And from concept or conception to actual groundbreaking, it will have taken over 6 years to get through to EPRD on the subject matter. But you know what? I wasn't worried about EPRD's board. I was worried about Bill Mounsey and what he thought of it. At first, he was categorically against any kind of anything going in Buchanan Park. And I was told that was because they were told when they agreed to purchase the land that it would stay au naturel, that there would be no building, no man-made things to get in the way of the nature of where there became part. And so it took a lot of lolling and a lot of explaining, and finally one day taking them over there to Buchanan Park to show both Bill and Louise what we had in mind. Finally, after about 45 minutes of wandering around on the actual premises of where this garden is going, Bill kind of shook his head. He said, yep, I think this is going to be okay. And Louise, she pretty much did the same thing. And so that was something that was hard won for me, knowing that Bill was okay with this. I knew eventually EPRD would get on board. I knew eventually many people would get on board. But impressing Bill enough with our plan meant more to me than any board or organizational work I've ever done could. Well-intentioned folks spend millions of dollars trying to find their purpose in life, but all they need to know, all they need to do is live like the Mounseys. Live their lives, their community pride and spirit, and their stick-to-itiveness when it comes to a worthy cause, this simply goes unmatched in the world today. So let's start a What Would Bill Do campaign of things to do in this town, or things to fix, or people to help, or support, or save. Next time, after you leave today and in the days to come, when someone asks you for a hand, someone asks you for a donation, someone asks you to support a worthy cause, all you gotta do is ask yourself, what would Bill do? And you'll be joined in short order. He would help out, and he would know just the right person to call about the issue if he himself wouldn't do something. In short, Bill would step up. And to honor him, I suggest we all step up next time we have the opportunity. Thank you.
Thanks, Tina. Speaking of projects, the mom and dad, for some reason, the summer started thinking about, you know, somewhere in the distant future they might be a place to be buried. And certainly not this soon, but anyway, they ended up in the old Evergreen Cemetery. And of course, they bought some plots, but it has also turned into a project. So dad and mom came up with all, I mean, I couldn't believe the next time I came down and all of the things that they thought should be done there to spruce it up, that it was a natural cemetery, but it sort of looked like an abandoned natural cemetery. So there are lots of things that could be done to spruce it up and make it even better, but still natural. So I don't think there's anything Dad ever touched that wasn't a project. Even going for a ride or getting a car, you know, a project of identifying car license plates or trees along the road or anything. Next is Barry Beardsley. He was in the Air Force, so we're actually quite lucky that he's a friend because Dad was an Army man. But he's a great friend, and he is the teller of tall tales and jokes, and he has promised to be appropriate today. Because there are women and children, not many innocent people, but a few women and children present. So, and he saved our behinds in the hospital. He and his wife, Mary. It was great. They were always there. They seem to know when they're needed, and they show up. So, here.
Really honored. When Louise called, I could not believe it. I'm going, there's so many people here that should be up here right now speaking. And but there are a number of stories. And I'm going to start off with a joke, because when I went to the hospital every day, I had two or three new jokes. So is there anybody here that knows why the Indians were the very first people here in North America? Because they have reservations. So, we're here to talk about Bill, and when Louise called me, one word came to my mind. Freedom. Bill fought in the Pacific, and he told stories, and I never heard the same story twice. And that's after about 8 years of hearing stories. And if you really want to know what Bill was like, there is one of the most famous lines in movies, and it's called, "Oh, how I love the smell of napalm in the morning." So next time you see that movie or hear about it, that was Bill crouching down on the Mekong Delta. It was just that he was in the big war, if you wish. Bill was a great shot. And he gave us freedom. In fact, today we're freedom, and half the globe is right now not in the very same situation. So we have our freedom to thank Bill for. He just dearly loved his wife of 71 years. What an honor to be married for 71 years. And while we were at the hospital, I heard a number of stories. And Bill was listening all the time. Actually it was Diana who was telling me a story. Bill was off shooting Japs in the Pacific in World War II. And Louise was doing laundry in someplace in the South. And Diana was sitting underneath a tree, and she was putting out the laundry to dry. And she looks over, and Diana was sitting underneath a tree reading a book. And she sees a snake. Well, there aren't too many non-poisonous snakes in the south part of the United States. So she went into the house, got a 45, and shot that snake. And the snake comes winding on down, and she looks up and, by golly, there was another snake. And she shot that snake too. So they were both pretty good shots. And the freedom that we have here, we have to give to Bill that wonderful honor. He also was very much a conservationist, and he was very involved in saving the Gila wilderness. Now that happens to be an area, as you go west, past Silverthorne, towards Vail. It's the mountains to the right. It's almost like a little Switzerland. And Louise told me actually this morning that he was up there mapping out the boundaries, and his maps were so accurate that once they decided to save the wilderness, they used his maps. And I used to fly for a living. I would fly on a day like this. Sometimes we'd ask to go direct to Eagle Airport or Aspen, and we'd fly right over the Gila Wilderness. No roads, no houses, no people, at least that I could see, because we're going 500 miles an hour. But the bottom line is, what a beautiful piece of property, and nobody will ever build on it. And that's another bit of freedom. The one thing I do have to talk about, Bill, or mention, is the fact that there's one group of people that he did not save us from. It was called the Internal Revenue Service. Anyway, the day after the funeral, about half an hour after the funeral, I'm driving up or down 70, and I get off at exit 254, Genesee Park, and I look up, and there's a bald eagle flying over. I've never seen a bald eagle in that part of Colorado. So I think I waved at Bill, and I think the eagle sort of went like this. But anyway, it was very much an honor to know Bill, and even more so for Louise. And be careful, she is a good shot.
Finally, I looked at his pipe, his tobacco pipe, and
said, "Do you think I could have a taste of that?" And he did. He gave me his pipe, and so Bill Go and I shared his pipe, and that was kind of our little peace truce. And then all the people came, and we did our trip. One of the things that was really amazing about the office was, I don't know if you know where the old Stagecoach building is. It's the old log cabins that are down by Church of the Transfiguration at the east end of Evergreen down there. And so I would go to work, and it would be in this old log building, and there was no heat, and there was no running water, and we had one telephone, and we would conduct business all day long all over the country. So, and Bill would come in with his satchel and all the different papers in there, and he had his little room next to mine, and he would set out all his papers, and we'd make all of our phone calls. And sometimes people would come in and look at us and what we were doing, and we became affectionately known as the PB&J gang because of how we conducted business. I don't know, there's lots of times that I had the honor of being around a campfire with Bill late into the night, and with people from all around the country, and singing songs and hearing stories, and inevitably the flask would come out after a while, and the stories would get better, and the songs would get louder. But anyways, Bill was a special person, and I think his whole family was special. And so I'm honored that I got to say a few words and honor that piece of his life, because it really was a special time. And the little log building is still down there, but it's no longer in person. Thank you.
Started out as Adventure Enterprises, which he first raced was when he was stationed at Fort Benning, Georgia in the late 50s, mid-50s. And as Elvis child, I remember him saying, "Now, when I get out of the Army, we're going to go to Colorado, and I'm going to tan. Who on earth would pay to haul this heavy canvas gear into the wilderness, no less?" And luckily, Dad probably knew this, but when he got out of the Army in 64, that was about the time that Jerry and Bowler started developing all of his lightweight gear. And so Dad was right on the forefront, but was trying to do it on Army retirement pay, which at that point barely bought groceries, much less support business. So, but he made it successful and mentored a whole lot of people who are now working in, you know, taking people into the wilderness. Al Patrick, he's a neighbor who worked with Dad on protecting Evergreen Park Estates through the Homeowners Association, and has a few words to say. Another one of Dad's hats.
Can you hear me without this?
Sure.
Yeah.
Worked very hard the last few days because Louise wanted me to say something at this event. And after you work like this and you know that you can't talk the rest of the afternoon like I did at the Colorado School of Mines, you have to boil it down. We went to church this morning, they were talking about Thanksgiving. And I thought, well, there it is in a couple of words. Thanks, Bill. You are a man that I admire, and I'm glad to be a person you really affected in terms of thinking about wilderness and open space. I called Larry Cirillo this morning. He's another one from the Evergreen Homeowners Association, and asked him for his input. We moved here in 1962 to build a house. We moved in January 1963. I checked with my wife. Across the street was a fellow called Al Huffman, who is a person of wilderness orientation, and Buffalo Bill, down in the corner with the, was the Hall family. And later that decade, up on the hill, was the Bill Mounsey family. So that was our connection. I thought I would collect some information and talk about our homeowners association. The association was sort of a challenge for everybody, including the people who came to the meetings that Bill attended. We had a large number of half-acre lots. In order to build a house where you didn't have water or a sewer connection, you had to allow at least 3 half acres in order not to pollute somebody else's land. That set the problems for the homeowners for sure, and Bill worked on that day after day, year after year, to try to resolve the problems where somebody wanted to build on 2 acres or 1 acre and pollute the neighbor's land with a septic system or take the water from somebody else. Bill Mounsey was a problem solver, and I enjoyed learning from him in that. We had a president and a group of people in the Homeowners Association that tried to meet and go to court if necessary to protect all the houses that were not wilderness, but at least we were close to open space. I sort of feel that the people who moved into that area were the kind that loved a place to go that was like it was 100 or 200 or 300 years ago. Anyway, our efforts were in that direction. This morning we had a meeting at the church, and it was Thanksgiving. So after I had been working on the information about Bill all this long, the thing that came to me was thanks. We just passed Thanksgiving. Thanks, Bill Mounsey. We appreciate what you did for all of us. When you went to court, for example, and somebody wanted to build their property and septic line and water supply on 2 acres or 1 acre. And of course, that led people to court down in Denver, where the homeowners would spend, if they went to court, $15,000, but there was only $5,000 in the account. Those are the kind of problems that we faced, and I think back to the days of Bill and his efforts to get things done. He went down there, and they told him that it wouldn't pass. They called it the place in Denver that was the courthouse. I guess these are the things that I remember battling with the group and trying to get something done. That was what Bill Mounsey was really good at, solving a problem and keeping at it until things turned right. Thank you.
Water that came out of it to come down to the Front Range. He still have the ball.
board photography guru, and I guess I first saw him a picture of Bill in Boyd's book, Wilderness Photography, which is still well-thumbed and very important to me. And Louise, when she was at the T-Cross Ranch with one of Boyd's photography workshops, and she waited in vain for me to arrive into the northern wilds of Wyoming. I mean, it had come from my office on a routine basis in the middle of the night. But anyway, I have got to know them a little bit, and I admired Bill very, very much for many reasons, not the least of which is that he fought for the freedom of everyone in the Pacific and during the war, and survived the battlefield injury that would have killed most people. It took 70 years for it to kill him, but he shows he's a very tough guy. But he obviously knew what he was fighting for, because after fighting in that grim and hideous war, he came home and worked for his community and to save the environment, and inspired many of us. At about that time, when I first met Boyd and Bill Louise, I became involved in the environmental movement in Colorado, which was not a completely new experience for me, but I got to a different level with photography. And in fact, my first photograph was for an environmental issue was of the Holy Cross Wilderness. It was a poster that I made for the Colorado Open Space Council and the Wilderness Workshop, which Bill was critical in founding. And in fact, I didn't even know at the time, but Bill, as you have heard, basically drew the boundaries for the new wilderness areas in Colorado and made that happen. So what I did in later starting the Holy Cross Wilderness Defense Fund was some backpacker friends of mine, and using photography and what I knew to help protect the environment there in the wilderness, was made possible by what Bill did. And so I'm very grateful to him in many ways, as I say. So he was an inspiration to me, and I loved him very much. He was definitely a character right out of history. In fact, whereas most of us experience the consequences of history, Bill was one of the persons who made history happen. And I think that, so his passing is not just an important loss for those of us who in his immediate family who loved him, and those of us who are friends and associates who loved him, but it's an important event in our history. Because here's a person who lived throughout the 20th century, and participated in the most important way in one of the critical events in all of world history. And he made it come out the right way with his life and dedication. And then he continued with that in a different way in civil society in Colorado. So we are all forever grateful to Bill for that. And the word, unique, is often used and sometimes overused. I think that Bill Mounsey was a person definitely to whom that applied. And I salute him from the bottom of my heart.
Sharon's son, and he's head of the Red Cross of Northern Colorado, so he does good work out there for us.
Thanks, Diana. Diana, it's pretty much an impossible task to speak on behalf of all the grandkids, but I will tell you that when I think of my grandfather, there certainly is a word that comes to mind, and that's family. Bill, amongst the many amazing things that he accomplished in life, he was an incredible father, husband, and grandfather, and great-grandfather. Family was very important to my grandfather. And share a little bit of a time in my own life when family really meant something very significantly. And this was 1993. It was not long after the death of my own father. And that really kind of uprooted me in life quite a bit. And I was going to school back in Oregon and decided to take the opportunity to come visit my grandparents in Colorado and move to Durango and begin going to school down there. And it was at this time that I realized that, someone had mentioned earlier about live like the Mounseys. And frankly, I don't know if I really understood what that was all about until I came to live with Bill and Louise. And I learned so much about what it is to be a Mounsey. And I think in the case of Bill, that's just simply a great person, a great family man, a great American. And it was mentioned earlier about Bill being a problem solver, and he certainly was. I can think of a time during that trip where Bill, if you've ever walked up the front of the house and you walked across those large sandstone pavers, the sidewalk to the front door, and well, that was one of the projects Bill had for me, and he wasn't going to leave me to it all by myself. But I remember, as a young man, looking at these large pavers and just thinking, this is going to be impossible. And one thing you should know about Bill Mounsey is, in his world, nothing was impossible. And it was really a neat experience for Bill. He loved to teach. That was one thing that if you worked around Bill much, he was an incredible problem solver, and he loved to share his love for knowledge and learning with the people around him. And so Bill breaks out a big rock and a big pole and starts teaching me about levers and fulcrums. And before long, we moved these giant stones into place and built a handy walkway there. And just a project that as a young man, I thought, no way, we're going to need a big piece of equipment in here. Bill was so good at being able to work with the environment that he was in that he could solve incredible problems. I can remember, this was in the waning days of Snowy Range Lodge. Many of you had the opportunity to go and experience the place up in Wyoming. And that summer, Bill took me up there a couple different times, and at one point, just to be up there by myself and stand guard at the facilities up there. I can remember camping in the little cabins with Bill, just experiencing something great in ourselves. That was something that Bill was so awesome at finding in his life, is connecting with the world around us, being in nature, and just being one with it. Really experiencing something that we often miss in this world today. And frankly, I've been missing most of my life, not getting out under the great big, amazing sky, seeing the stars, seeing what life is really about. I think it was on that trip up there that I first had a glimpse of just something so much greater than myself. And Bill was so instrumental in showing that to me. Bill was just simply, if I can wrap things up, one of these individuals that you just rarely come across in life. I put in a little slideshow here, if you get a chance to watch that. Bill was a rare bird. Absolutely was. That was commented on at his funeral. And Bill truly was one of these individuals who saw the world a little bit differently than everyone else around him. I think one of the things that I saw visiting with Bill and Louise was this amazing part about being a Mounsey that I didn't get before. About where they could drive around and identify every animal, identify every tree, every plant, every bird. And all of a sudden, the world around me really just started opening up, becoming so much greater than what it had been. If there is anything that I hope you remember about Bill and his relationships with his grandkids, is he always just had an incredible, loving heart. Some of us saw him more than others. Some just grew up with him and experienced that directly. But Bill was an incredible family man. Thank you.
Now I'll tell a little story of him. When John was born, he was a beautiful baby. grandchild to be born where mom and dad were, and so they had a lot of contact with him. Everybody was like, oh, what a beautiful baby, oh, what a beautiful baby. So dad said, oh, I've got to do something about this. I'm going to call him Little Ugly. And so, and mother said, but we're going to call you Big Ugly then. And so those were the names for dad and my son, John.
Good afternoon, everybody. Yeah, a little ugly.
Can't hear you.
Yeah, I'm not even going to pass it. Can you hear me in the back? I'm going to pass this around. Don't worry if you drop it. It's pretty bulletproof. It's my goalie helmet that I play hockey in that I kind of painted for Big Ugly. Speech. Louise asked me to speak, and outside of not running in a house, you didn't ask much, so something short and sweet like Louise baby. Phil was here, he would be, well, flattered, to be certain. He would have that smile that we all knew. That we knew that he knew something more than all of us. All the children and grandchildren were very lucky because we didn't have a grandfather, we had Bill. That was awesome. And of course, Louise baby. Bill's larger than life from his hands, his stature, which terrified me as a child, his voice, his life experience, and his mustache, which I was always jealous of. I look ridiculous with a mustache. His voice, you know. As children, Bill and Louise taught us to love nature and knowledge through the universe, the wilderness, the mountains, the deserts, rivers, canoeing out here, which I got yelled at. I don't know. And Mary, when she was talking about the green trucks, I destroyed one of Bill's trucks when I was 4 or 5. Remember when I kicked him in the gear and I found him? As adults, Bill really loved to bust all the grandchildren's chops with the questions on intellect and the Indian pictographs and stuff. Great. Bill's great intellect is of course matched by Louise's unbridled love. Sorry. Which, like her cooking and garden, it's scrumptious. And anyone that's basked in it, it's warmth and greenness knows how grand that is. Sorry, I missed the old guy. The richest of our lives, thanks. The richest of our lives is reflected by Bill and Louise. And when I got back home after the service last Sunday, I was telling friends that it's much more of a state of whoa than a state of whoa with all the military pop and circumstance and the guns and the flag. I mean, excuse my French, but that was just kidding ass. I have a great deal of pride knowing that I have, and many of us in this room have built blood flowing through us.